Welcome to For the Health of It, Because You Can, where host Susan Robinson dives into the 8 categories of wellness with experts from various fields. We offer tips and information to help you thrive in all areas of individual wellness.
Hello, everybody. We have a very special first guest today, whom I've known for almost 20 years and consider him to be my first mentor in the area of stress management. He has a PhD in psychophysiology, which is the study of the mind-body connection. He is taught at the University of Maryland, American University, the University of Colorado, and the University of Northern Colorado. He is known both nationally and internationally as an expert in stress management and mind-body-spirit healing. He's authored many books, one being Stressed is Dessert Spelled Backwards. He also authored an academic textbook, which I used personally when I taught in higher education. He had the opportunity to share insights with our nation's White House staff, work with Olympic athletes, large corporations such as Procter & Gamble, and the United States military. He offers certification training in holistic stress management at numerous health and wellness conferences and at locations in his home state of Colorado. I'm so excited to introduce Brian Luke Seward.
Morning. Hello from Boulder, Colorado.
Welcome to the podcast. As you know, the pandemic has affected many people, but you're an expert in this, have been for years when I first met you when I was in grad school. So I want to ask you a few questions. Can you address the issues of stress in our culture, work site, even the planet today?
Yes, we have a lot going on. Concise about this, we're in times of great change right now. And by and large, people don't like change. In fact, I love the expression that says the only person who likes change is a wet baby. And we've got tremendous change going on right now. And with change, there's uncertainty. And with uncertainty, there is this idea, the fear of the unknown. And there's a lot of unknown things going on right now. So that's the general angst. But there's also a lot of anger because things aren't the way they used to be. And, you know, we're now kind of like saying before pandemic and during pandemic and post-pandemic, but it turns out that a lot of people, although they were very stressed before the pandemic, they kind of long for some of the things that some of the lifestyle aspects that are no longer with us, like, you know, being able to travel more freely. Although that's coming back, having some of your favorite restaurants close down. There's a lot of stress going on in the world right now. And the news actually is just rife with all kinds of stress stories. So yeah, we're in times of great change and there's more change coming, I think. And I always see change as a positive thing. I think that we can always learn from this. However, not everyone thinks the same way, but I think we want to try and steer people in the direction of how can we adapt to the change we're going through? That's the key. If there's a message to this whole podcast is how can we adapt gracefully to the change we're going through?
All right. How's that affecting the work side? And did the pandemic affect our planet?
I don't have a TV, but someone said you really got to check this BBC special about when the world was shut down for like 6 months. Wildlife began to come into the cities. Now they were seeing coyotes in New York City. They were seeing leopards walk into some of the places in Africa. They would never see them. To me, the most significant thing was the lack of pollution, the air pollution. People in various cities, Los Angeles, I think Kathmandu, they could see mountains they hadn't seen in years because the air was clear. So yeah, so there were some good things. But you know, in terms of the work site, the biggest thing we're seeing right now is people who had learn to work remotely, doing it well, and then are called back to the work site and on location. And some of these people don't want to do that. And it's because, you know, the traffic situations, because the freedom of being able to access your computer whenever you want. You know, I listened to a story on NPR about what was going on with the work site during the pandemic and post-pandemic. And it turned out that the number of hours people worked on their computer for their occupation increased during the pandemic because they could kind of come and go and things. And, you know, we live in a 24/7 society. A lot of people who have access to their computer are now in touch with people all around the world. And the 9-to-5 shift has expanded to 24/7.
All right. So talking about the stressors during the pandemic and now the post, but what were the biggest stressors people had before the pandemic?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that. The two biggest things we saw, Susie, were alienation and isolation. People really felt as if they were alienated. And a lot of this has to do with the technology, which I'm not going to bash because technology is great, but it's how it was used. But a lot of people felt cut off, and we saw this big factor of loneliness. And that then became part of the aspect of a lack of purpose in life. And so these kind of wove together in, you know, what am I doing? Who am I? And no one knows or cares about me. And we are a social being. We are not meant to be isolated. And I got to tell you, then the pandemic came, and then that just magnified everything. And so we saw lots more depression, lots more alcoholism, lots more suicide, all kinds of problems that just went exponential. And now that the pandemic's over, we're returning to a better sense of a new normal, if you will. One thing I like about the pandemic was it gave us a chance to observe our behavior and make some changes. And, you know, the big thing about stress management is behavior modification. How can we alter or change some negative behaviors toward the positive, or really just come back to balance? And I think a lot of people in the field of psychology, sociology, worksite wellness took a look at what was going on in our lifestyles during the pandemic and said, we need to make a course correction here. And so it was a time for a reset. And I'd like to invite all the listeners to think to themselves now, we've had a chance to reflect and see where we can make some slight tweaks in our own behaviors to come back to balance. This is the ultimate destination, is back to balance, back to homeostasis, back to inner peace.
Good. All right. So what are the biggest stressors you would say now or post-pandemic?
I think there's still a lot of uncertainty. You know, I just got done doing the new edition of my textbook, and I put three things down that I thought were really part of this new post-pandemic period that we're in. One is economic uncertainty. You know, this has been going on for a while, but it seems like it's in exponential favor right now. But things like the stock market, things like the price of eggs, the cost of buying a new home, the cost of rent, all these things have gone up. And this is definitely going to put a squeeze on people financially. Another thing to consider is climate change. Right now in Colorado, where I live, and hopefully you're not experiencing this, we have a really poor air quality index because the fires from Canada. There's huge fires with the winds and the currents, and I'm not sure, airstreams bringing that smoke down to Colorado that they're saying don't go outside. And that's part of climate change. You know, whether it's floods or droughts or fires or hurricanes or the crisis du jour, this is going to impact us on how we live, you know, whether it's the heat index or you name it. The third one, I think, is how do we navigate our lives in all of this cultural change? There's a lot of cultural change. You may have heard the term culture wars going on. And again, I think a lot of people are just trying to make a name for themselves. But we see a lot of people who are influencing our society, and not in good ways. And so we got lots of things on the horizon here.
A year ago, I did a survey with state employees, and quite a bit, over 60% said they were stressed or highly stressed, and that was after the past 18 months, which was basically during the pandemic. But then a lot of them, at least half, said that they were burned out. So there is a difference in being stressed and burned out. How can you, what are the signs of burnout, and how does that compare with the daily stress?
Yeah, great question. I was made aware of a new study that came out actually a couple of years ago now by the World Health Organization on burnout. And they said that burnout definitely is an issue and a force to be reckoned with. What we basically see is people who are overly fatigued, their concentration skills are very, very poor. The communication skills are not good because they're tired. And work performance definitely decreases. And so it's kind of like an apathy of, I just don't have the energy to do anything anymore. You know, one of the words we heard a lot used during the pandemic, and it's been used now as well, is exhaustion. People are exhausted. Trying to run a family, trying to teach your kids when they were doing the online program at school during the pandemic, and then to work your 8 hours or get your job done and stuff. We were burning the candle at both ends and in the middle, and it was complete burnout. Daily stress, if there is a difference, and some people kind of put them all together, but daily stress is feeling a bit anxious or angry about something not going the way we thought it was going to go. So there's the fight or flight response is either anger or fear in a very large categorical description here. Burnout is more exhaustion and just low energy. And I will tell you right now, we're seeing a lot of that with a lot of people, and we're going to dip into sleep in a second here, I know, but one reason why that people are exhausted and burnt out is we're just not sleeping very well. And this was going on before the pandemic. It's exponential now.
I agree with you. I talk about this all the time with employees, how many think it's almost wearing a badge that, oh, I only got 5 hours sleep, or they almost wear it like it's a badge, but they don't realize what it's done to their health. So we worked with the state employees during the pandemic, and many of them lost family, friends to COVID. And so it seemed like, and even myself, I lost family. How we pushed that grieving down, and I said, it will arise when this is over, the stuff you've pushed down. So can you talk a little more about the grieving process and maybe some steps to help people kind of get through that, which still may be part of the burnout, is that they have not dealt with that?
Yeah, definitely. Great question. And a great, great topic. What I've heard a lot in the past 2 years is this topic of trauma. And this ties real directly to the idea of grieving, because whenever we are put into a situation that is traumatizing, regardless of what the situation is, we have a lot of people going through trauma. In fact, their experts are saying that COVID was a world traumatic event. And so everybody's experiencing trauma. And there's different types of trauma. There's acute, where it's like a single event. Let's say that you're in a horrible car accident. There's chronic trauma, where you have repeated problems of stress. I'm going to put an example of being raised by abusive alcoholic parents. That would be in the category of a chronic trauma. There's community trauma, and then there's generational trauma too. So we're now learning that trauma is very, very complex in its ways that it shows up and manifests. But a large part of how to deal with trauma is to grieve properly, grieve the loss. And so when I first saw where things are going with the pandemic, I thought to myself, wow, we need to learn to adapt. And the first stage of adaptation is healthy grieving. We need to learn to acknowledge that there has been a loss. And, there's male bravado. There's people who say, I'll deal with that later. Right now, I got to deal with this right now. And they, as you said, they put off the grieving. I have a good friend who was down in New Orleans during the Hurricane Katrina as an example of this. And a lot of her friends were into building, and the minute that the dust cleared or the skies cleared, they went to work trying to rebuild houses, stuffing their loss and their emotional loss. A year later, it came back and bit them in the butt, because they were having severe depression and all kinds of health problems. So we need to acknowledge the loss, and whether it's just to talk to a counselor and a therapist, which I highly recommend, or whether it's to sometimes to do what we call as a healthy catharsis. Take a piece of paper and pencil or pen and just write down your thoughts, your feelings. And if that feels awkward, what some people say, try doing it in a form of a poem. Poetry therapy is important too. And the whole idea with this is how to make order out of chaos. Chaos is another word for stress. Chaos is trauma exponential. But if we can make some kind of sense of it, some kind of order out of it, and I'm not trying to advocate rainbows and unicorns right now, because I know it's very, very serious. And we've all gone through this. But I think for us to come back to balance, we need to acknowledge the loss, and we need to do some healthy grieving. And part of it is just to acknowledge that indeed that there has been a loss. And then, you know, sometimes to talk it out with friends and family. Again, I'm going to say very important to get a therapist or a counselor, someone who is specializes in the fact of loss. And there are a lot of great people out there doing this right now. And then also part of the grieving process, which is really important, is to give something back. Because as bad as you've had it, someone's got it worse. And so, you know, whether it's, you know, to volunteer for an hour in the soup kitchen or to give some of your, clean out your closet and give some of your clothes to you know, whatever outfit can be there to share some things, because, you know, we can all, helping other people helps us resolve our trauma.
Yes, I agree with that. Part of what I think is as far as the burnout, as well as being stressed, but as a part of grieving, is anger seems to be rearing its ugly head. It just seems like people are just more angry when they're driving, when they're dealing with, they're treating waitstaff poorly. It's just amazing at how much anger just happens like that. So can you talk a little bit about what happens with mismanagement of anger?
Yeah, boy, we can spend a whole hour on this. There's so much to talk about, but real briefly. Well, first of all, let me preface this by saying anger is a healthy emotion. Okay, it's not bad. It's part of the continuum of emotions. How we choose to deal with the anger may not be healthy, and that's what we want to address. But also, I want to tell you that every time someone gets angry, it's because of an unmet expectation. And like, for example, you know, you thought your plane was going to leave on time and it didn't, or you thought your son or daughter was going to fill the gas tank and they didn't. Every time we get angry, it's because of an unmet expectation. And take a look at the world today. There are so many unmet expectations, which is going to lead to a lot of frustration and rage and hostility and anger being played out. And before the pandemic even took hold, there was talk of a huge mental health care crisis going on in our country. But now we have an exponential mental health care crisis. And what we need to do is as best we can, work with both the anger and the anxiety with that. But let me tell you something about anger, which I think is really important. First of all, not everyone exhibits anger the same way or demonstrates it the same way. And now, obviously, there's healthy anger, and we'll get to that in a second, but I want to mention something about unhealthy anger, or we call mismanaged anger. So let me just toss out a couple of styles here and see if the audience can relate to any of these. Because if you're human and you're honest with yourself, you're going to say, yep, that's me. Okay, there's four styles of mismanaged anger. The first one's called a somatizer. And a somatizer is someone who doesn't express their anger, they suppress their anger. The word soma means body. I think it's in Greek. And so the somatizer is somebody who, because they don't express their anger, it shows up in a physical health problem. And I'll give you some examples. Hopefully no one in the audience can relate to these, although I think they can. The first one is TMJ, temporomandibular joint dysfunctions, where you grind your teeth at night. And the reason why you do it at nighttime when you sleep is because in the daytime, you are the nicest person. Another example is migraine headaches. Now, not every migraine headache is anger related or somatizer, but a large percentage of them are. And then we have this whole category of diseases called autoimmune diseases. And if you were to look up, Google the term autoimmune disease, you're going to see a definition that says, the body attacks the body. The minute you hear the word attack, you should think unresolved anger going on here. Now, a lot of this is we don't have enough time to go into all the details, and I'm just kind of giving a categorical explanation here. So there's always exceptions, but just kind of go for the concept as we go on here. The next style of mismanaged anger is called the exploder, and this person erupts like a volcano, and their hot lava goes in the path of intimidation. So, you know, we hear about school bullies in school when we were growing up, and they still happen now. But this could also be someone who does road rage or sports rage or tarmac rage or airplane rage. We saw a lot of that in the past couple of months. So this is someone trying to intimidate somebody else. And it's, these are all bad. They're not good. Don't do any of these. But the explosive behavior is almost opposite of the somatizer behavior. The third one is called the self-punisher. And the self-punisher is somebody who feels guilty about feeling angry because of how we've been socialized. And as a consequence, they go into what is known as an obsessive compulsive behavior. They do excess eating, excess sleeping, excess binge watching TV, excess exercise. I knew it once a guy who was not happily married, but he stayed married because he had two kids. So he took up marathon running. You don't have to be a therapist to realize he was running away from his problems. But then when that didn't work, he took up ultra marathon running, 50 mile events. The guy was never home, but now he's got two knee replacements because of the wear and tear in his body there. So that's called self-punishment. And then, of course, we also have people who used to be called cutters, now they're called self-mutilation. This is in the category of this as well. And the last one that we see at the worksite, it's the underhander. And the underhander's motto is, don't get mad, get even. And these are people who try to seek revenge. And they do it, oftentimes socially acceptable means, the most common of which is sarcasm. Then you may have heard, this one's kind of comical, but not really. The expression, oh, didn't you get the memo? Well, sometimes this form of office sabotage is not communicating to someone something very important, and they end up looking like an idiot. I gave a talk at Blue Cross Blue Shield one time, and the CEO said to me, oh my God, we've just been profiled. And I said, what do you mean? He said, we call this information withholding. So all of these are bad. None of these are good. But if you see yourself as any one of those, and by the way, you can be a underhander at work. You can be an exploiter driving home from work, and you can be a self-punisher once you get home. You can do all of these things. But one style seems to be most prevalent. And what we now say is that observe your behavior and then drop the label. No longer do this behavior because it's not beneficial. Back to somatizers, when I first heard this, I thought to myself, oh my God, that's me. And I love the expression that says the body becomes a battlefield for the war games of the mind.
I hope you enjoyed part one of our interview with Dr. Brian Luke Seward. Be on the lookout for part two on the next episode.
Thank you for listening to For the Health of It. For more wellness tips, information, and videos, visit the Thrive webpage. For questions, contact us at thrive@oms.ok.gov.